So first, I want to take you back to 2014. I was a sophomore in college, and if you'd seen me on the street and said, "Lexi, you're not going to go to law school after you graduate. You're going to do some other master's program," and I'd say, "No, you've got the wrong person. Sorry." Then if you said to me, no, really, you're going to be working in one of the buzziest, fastest moving tech spaces that we really have right now, I would have said, first of all, who are you? Why do you keep following me around? Stop trying to predict my future right now. All joking aside, what I want to talk to you about today is kind of my career path, how I got here, why I'm talking to you about blockchain technology when I originally went into college as a classical voice major. I studied opera for a while. Then why does blockchain technology matter? Why should you care about it? We've heard a lot of people talking about cryptocurrencies today. I want to talk beyond that into the technology behind it itself. And then how blockchain still needs builders of all types and how you can get involved, even if you're not a programmer. So just first a little bit about my journey. So I mentioned that I went and matriculated to Pepperdine University in California as a classical voice major. I'd been singing since about the age of 3, but never really wanted to be a professional opera singer for my career. What really interested me was the changing nature of the music industry and how things like illegal downloads and streaming platforms were changing the way that artists were being compensated for their work, how the various sampling and genre changes would affect copyright law. And so that was something that I was really interested in. And about halfway through, I figured that being a political science major and having my concentration be pre-law might be the best way to participate in this new and changing industry. But as I was going along and taking my courses, learning about world governments and et cetera, what I found really interested me was not only how the music industry was changing, but how technology in general was changing the way other industries were being practiced, and then also how nascent technologies were being regulated. So I switched my degree to political science, and I started researching as feverishly as I could about new technologies that might change the way the law is practiced. So examples of these might be machine learning algorithms that could make finding precedent a matter of minutes as opposed to a matter of several days and hours. How natural language processing could play into different types of record keeping. And so along my kind of travels in research over the internet, I discovered this phrase called, called smart contracts. And so being the curious law student that I was, I said, okay, contracts, that's definitely something that's in the legal space. I think it's one of the first classes that you take as a law student, actually. What's so special about smart contracts? I had first read about it in the context of a new cryptocurrency that had been, at the time, invented by a boy genius programmer who was about the same age that I was, but was inventing a totally new type of cryptocurrency called Ethereum. And smart contracts were part of the bedrock of his new platform, which used the token Ether. And once I really started to dig into this, I found that smart contracts was actually a term that had been coined about 20 years prior to that release by a technologist named Nick Szabo, and he classifies it as such. Smart contracts are a set of promises specified in digital form, including protocols within which the parties perform on these promises. So what exactly does that mean? One example is of a vending machine. If you think about this as kind of a physical manifestation of a smart contract, right? So you've got the promise that if you put a certain amount of money, say 75 cents, into a vending machine and then click a button, without human intervention, the machine will give you a Coke or Sprite, whatever you ordered, automatically. So it's really a set of specifications, one that has to occur for then an event to be automatically executed. And this is one of the technologies that's involved it with blockchain technology generally. So I became intensely interested in this, started researching blockchain technology more generally. I went through Bitcoin talk forums. There were thought leaders on Twitter and Reddit who were talking about a lot of this stuff. Then I eventually started going to some of my local meetups and trying to meet some of the people who were actually involved in this space. And it culminated in a trip that I took to New York, literally the day after I graduated, for what is now known as the largest conference in our space called Consensus. And there, I was able to actually meet all of these people whose work I had been reading about for the last several months. I was able to see other people who were just as captivated about this somewhat esoteric new technology, and from that point decided that I really wanted to push my career in that direction and stop studying for the LSAT, which was a relief, not for my parents though at the time, and was inspired by an initiative that was talked about at that very conference that Delaware was putting out, where they were trying to create a more friendly environment for blockchain. And I figured, has anyone thought about this with the state of Illinois? We have a network of elite universities. We're the center of some of the most important financial services in the world. We have a great talent pool, VCs that are open to the idea of new technologies like this. Why can't Illinois and Chicago in particular be the center for blockchain innovation? And so, to my elation, the Department of Innovation and Technology, we worked together with several other agencies to then put together the Illinois Blockchain Initiative, which at the time was one of the less punitive and fear-based pieces of legislation that was put out from any of our states here, that was really trying to create a welcoming environment for blockchain technology. From then, I met my our co-founder at Block, which is the company that I currently work for, which is dealing mostly with, on the one hand, providing enterprise-grade blockchain software and services for large enterprises, small companies, and developers to help them interact more with the public blockchain networks, and on the other hand, helping to build new companies that could not have existed without blockchain and cryptocurrencies. Like, we have a project called Titan, which is mining optimization software, and we have a new cryptocurrency we put out called Metronome, which, in addition to being the first DAO or autonomous organization not to break Ethereum in half, is also the first cross-blockchain cryptocurrency, meaning that its value isn't tied to a particular chain. And then the past couple of years, I've had the privilege of serving as the executive director of the Chicago Blockchain Center, which is really trying to elevate and celebrate the Chicago blockchain community. And so we do this by putting together various events. We have resources for students and startups that really want more help in kind of their burgeoning journey. Do lectures that are industry specific, you name it. We're just a group of volunteers that are really, really passionate about trying to see this space thrive. And we were very lucky to have both public and private support for this effort. So before I get a little bit ahead of myself, why should you care about blockchain? Why does it matter? And I think it really all comes back to something that we've, you know, to my great happiness, we've heard a lot about today, which is its very first and still longest running use case, Bitcoin. So Bitcoin, as you guys, I think, probably know, you seem very, very savvy about cryptocurrency in this room, but it was created in 2009 in somewhat of a reaction to the Great Recession that we experienced in 2008. And Satoshi's vision was to try to create a peer-to-peer digital currency that, instead of relying on third-party validators or intermediaries to secure the network and make sure it proliferates, you're actually economically incentivized to validate and verify transactions in a global borderless network. So this, amongst many other things, made it a very open source and purely democratic effort. No one knows the identity of Satoshi Nakamoto still to this day. A few people have claimed to be Satoshi without providing some of the proper proof, but we still don't know for sure. And so what we ended up with was this kind of crazy, really purely democratic effort with lots of different global players that anyone can contribute to, even to this day. And as a couple of the other speakers were mentioning, it hasn't been hacked since its 2009 launch, despite some of the more salacious headlines you might see in this space. And why I really thought it was a game changer is because blockchain And specifically, Bitcoin is the first example, proved this idea of digital scarcity. There are only 21 million Bitcoin that are ever going to be in existence, and it makes it, due to the way the network is set up and with the validators and miners, it makes it very difficult to double spend. So an example of a non-scarce digital asset, for example, would be if I see maybe something funny that my friend's puppy did. I take a picture of it. I send it to my sister. Now, she and I both have that picture on our phones, and she has the option to save it, delete it, make a meme out of it, and then that picture spreads on the internet exponentially, and I've lost control of that asset. So Bitcoin was one of the first ways that we could prove something that is completely native digitally, completely composed of code online, could actually be a scarce digital resource, something that's not really backed by anything physical. And it blockchain enabled this immutability and unaltering of certain historic records. So if none of that really convinced you as to why you should get involved in this space, it's really been in the news a lot lately this week. Some of these screenshots are even from this morning, but the president tweeted about it. He said that Bitcoin is highly volatile and based on thin air, although some of us could argue that certain assets that we're much more comfortable using, like maybe even the dollar, aren't even backed by anything. That's a whole other presentation. But the Treasury Secretary came out with basically a warning to those in the cryptocurrency space who he said, you know, don't use this for illegal purposes, which it's one of the worst things you can use, actually, Bitcoin specifically. I mean, we don't need to get into different privacy coins like Monero and Zcash, but he was talking mostly about Bitcoin. And then even just from this morning, we saw Dave Marcus, who's leading Facebook's efforts for entering into this cryptocurrency space, testifying before Congress and was just getting absolutely drilled on this topic. So it's really, now is the time to kind of start paying attention if you haven't been already. Lots of other large companies have been experimenting in smaller ways by doing smaller public or private or permissioned blockchain pilots. But I think we're going to see a trend in the future with more large companies entering into it in a significant way, like Facebook has been trying to. So really all this to say is that this space is only about 10 years old. The word blockchain hasn't even been around for that long. That was actually a colloquialism that wasn't even mentioned in the original Bitcoin white paper. I think Satoshi called it a timestamp server, something like that. But really, this space is, I think, going to be the new trusted, verifiable bedrock of the internet. And because of that, we're going to need a lot of different types of professionals with a lot of different backgrounds to really become part of this space and help build these new networks of the futures, of the future. We're going to need economists. I saw some people raise their hand that they're economists, since there's a lot of uncertainty as to how new tokenized networks are going to be run, these new token economies that maybe use a combination of IoT and AI and cryptocurrency in order to execute transactions that occur autonomously from machine to machine. So we need economists to help build those models, since it's something that's never been done before. We need data scientists to help parse through the almost unimaginable amounts of data that are produced by all of the large public blockchain networks, so we can see on a smaller level what's really happening. We need social scientists. We need anthropologists, sociologists, who can help us understand and manage some of the new, almost completely online communities that have come about as a result of blockchain technology and cryptocurrencies. And we need marketing executives and advertisers to help build some of these new models of the future. One of my favorite projects in this space is called the Brave Browser. Raise your hands if you guys have heard about that, with the basic attention token, right? So what they're really trying to do is change the advertising, flip the advertising model on its head, and move away from a world where the users are the products and the advertisers are the customers, where a lot of our personal data is being shared. We had a great talk about security earlier today, that there's still so much vulnerability in some of those models. But instead, they're trying to move to a world where you can use trace amounts of cryptocurrency to compensate creators directly online, as opposed to having your personal data be the product and not be compensated for that. And then lastly, we need designers. I think Chief Mo's to help me design a better presentation for next time that is a little more visually appealing, but really to help build new applications that are just easier to use, since one of the biggest barriers to entry in this space right now is that it's so hard to get onboarded into the cryptocurrency ecosystem. You don't want to lose your private keys. If you're not a technologist, maybe you don't feel comfortable enough even participating, since there isn't that fail-safe or forget your password option with a lot of cryptocurrencies. So we need designers to help lead the way in making some of these applications more accessible. And so I'll leave you with this. This revolution was born online, and it still is headless. There aren't really, I mean, there are certain thought leaders that have come about, but so much of that information out there is for the taking if you're brave enough to go out and seek it. And so if an opera singer could do it, you definitely can too. Thank you so much.
We read dozens of news sources, so you only have to read one. John Lothian News.